The robots have come.
Once they get the algo really going.
They get them measuring everything we do. Get us competing against it. Who can beat a computer? Eventually, the only human left is the guy feeding the machines.
No computer can get the kind of info I can, or know what to do with it the way I do.
Let's talk about how AI will impact investing and these other finance lessons from the third episode of Billion Season 3, based on my work experience at Goldman Sachs in New York City, and based on my work experience at the top hedge funds in the world. Now, please like, comment, and subscribe, and stick around, because at the end of this video, I'm gonna grade the episode for Wall Street Realism with a buy, hold, or sell rating. In this episode, Axe Capital is considering hiring quants to use computers to pick stocks. And some of the employees are terrified that computers or AI-based investing will take their jobs.
No fear.
Absolutely. Fear.
Really?
Nope. Scared.
Me too.
Yeah, I'm totally scared.
So the reason that portfolio manager Dollar Bill is not scared is because he picks stocks based on insider information, which computers and AI might not be able to do, as his corrupt insider information tips are most likely not in digital format, but through private, undocumented conversations. On the other hand, Mafi, who is a trader, is terrified because he thinks that AI and quant-based investing can take his job away. And he's actually right to be scared, as some traders will be replaced by AI. In fact, at many hedge funds, traders are referred to as execution, as they merely execute the orders that portfolio managers like Dollar Bill gives them. Now, I think that traders and back office employees at hedge funds should be worried, as AI will replace many of them. And the most secure job for now when it comes to the threat of AI at hedge funds is the portfolio manager who decides what stocks to buy. However, the analysts that report to portfolio managers like Ben Kim here should be worried about AI replacing a lot of the analytical tasks like updating and forecasting financial models. Therefore, in the future, portfolio managers will need fewer analysts reporting to them. And as a result, Ben Kim freaks out in this episode.
My mother begged me to code at Stanford, but I went for applied mathematics, which seemed, you know, smarter then. But now, not only is she going to be proven right, but I'm going to be replaced by people who listen to their mothers and learn to code.
So the ironic thing is, it seems logical to study computer science from a job security perspective. However, Jensen Huang, who is the iconic founder of AI powerhouse NVIDIA, recently said that students should not study computer science because AI is perfect to replace developers who write code. Instead, Jensen said to study liberal arts. His argument is that studying liberal arts encourages students to be more creative when it comes to idea generation. And Steve Jobs used to always say that Apple is at the intersection of technology and the liberal arts. So perhaps Jensen is correct from an innovation or design perspective. Now, Jensen Huang also said that he thinks that the American educational system will pass other countries in the future. Because when you go to university in the United States, unlike other countries, you start by studying liberal arts, and then you choose your major in your second or third year at university. And Trader Mafi vents to on-site psychiatrist Wendy, given the threat of being replaced by computers.
The whole idea that we could all be replaced? This quant thing has me all f***ed up.
So Wendy, the in-house psychiatrist, urges them not to worry yet.
We are not being replaced. Will there be augmentation of some kind? Yes. Will it ask you, us, to raise our game? Yes. But we have to want that for this place, don't we?
No.
So what's fascinating is there's now a clear tension in many hedge funds between employees with a technology focus and employees with a pure investing focus. And the reality is that we all need to embrace AI and use it as a competitive weapon or we will be replaced. And this is best said by Jensen Huang from NVIDIA.
First of all, I'm gonna go to the punchline. AI is not gonna take your jobs. The person who uses AI is gonna take your job. Do you guys agree with that? Okay, so use AI as fast as you can so that you could stay gainfully employed.
Although he's biased, he's right. And later on in this video, I'm gonna give you tips on how to use AI to pick stocks. Now, I think that we need to try to disrupt ourselves by using AI to be more productive in all aspects of our job. It's kind of like what Netflix co-founder Reed Hastings did many years ago when he disrupted his own DVD rental mail service with streaming. Clearly, that was the future of entertainment. but investors were upset initially with him. And so we need to be very, very long-term focused when it comes to how we think AI can help and hurt our jobs. And that's a much better approach than simply feeling threatened like Mephi does.
Yep, this is how it ends.
Civilization.
First, it makes things better for you, then it destroys you. This is how computers take over the world.
Yeah, but I have heard about other funds that bring in quants, and it doesn't sound good. Once they get the algo really go.
Eventually, the only human left is the guy feeding the machine.
So what exactly is a quant? Well, portfolio manager Taylor says it best.
Quant is another word for systemized ordered thinking represented in an algorithmic approach to trading.
Now, old school traditional investors hate AI because they either feel threatened or they have really bad memories of AI gone wrong, like this event right here.
Let me remind you, August 2007.
The Dow crashed 400 points because of a coding error.
Accurate. And I remember August of 2007, as that month, the crappiest stocks went up a lot and the best stocks went down a lot. And at that time, we heard that AI-based hedge fund powerhouse Renaissance and the Goldman Sachs Alpha Fund got destroyed then because of the coding error that Taylor referred to. And Renaissance is the best AI-based hedge fund in history, with an average return since the 1980s of over 60%. Now, the late Jim Simmons founded Renaissance in the early 1980s after he left the NSA. And Renaissance prefers to hire mathematicians instead of employees with a background in finance. And for decades, Renaissance has been using machine learning, which is a subset of AI, to materially outperform the markets. And we will never know how Renaissance makes money, but they likely run thousands of Linux servers in parallel, picking stocks based on a gazillion data inputs. Now, a very simplistic example might be something like this. If it rains a lot in certain areas, then short restaurant stocks, because people don't go out to eat often when it rains. And yes, that was a very simplistic example. And people also use behavioral finance data to pick stocks. Now, for example, with behavioral finance, you analyze publicly available data on when CEOs or founders buy their own stocks, and you run a machine learning technique called regression analysis in Excel, for example, to see if the stock is higher 1 year after they buy and vice versa when they sell. And I used to do this with Bobby Kotick, the founder and CEO of Activision, as I noticed that when he bought his stock in size, the stock was often higher a year later and vice versa. And of course, that regression analysis trade doesn't work anymore as Microsoft bought Activision. But you can always look for patterns on insider selling and insider buying and how stocks perform after the insider transactions. And a lot of hedge funds actually do this. And of course, they don't share this money-making tip with anybody. And Nobel Prize winner in finance, Richard Fuller, is the father of behavioral finance. Now, in order to analyze companies where there may be massive insider buying, we can always look for his portfolio from his mutual fund called Fuller & Taylor. So what we can do is we can use SeekingAlpha.com to analyze his portfolio. So let's type in the word behavioral and then click here to see what is in this Fuller & Taylor fund. Then we can look at the holdings of his fund. And then you can do your own research on these companies in his portfolio to see if there's been insider buying, and if so, has the stock performed well by doing a regression analysis? Now, I've been using Seeking Alpha for years to screen stocks, and in past videos, I've used Yahoo Finance for screening. But if you're a more advanced, meaning not a beginner investor, then I recommend checking out Seeking Alpha. There's a link in the description to get a discount on Seeking Alpha, and full disclosure, I do partner with Seeking Alpha. Now, if you want to learn more about how to use Excel or Python or AI products to help you become a better investor, then please check out these courses of mine from my website, and the link is also in the description. Let's talk about grading this episode for Wall Street Realism with a buy, hold, or sell rating. The episode did a great job of showing the fear that analysts and traders have when it comes to computer-based or algorithmic trading. The episode also did a great job of providing examples of why investors are fearful of AI as well, because of the coding error that hurt AI-based funds like Renaissance in August of 2007. And the episode also correctly showed that corrupt portfolio managers that profit on insider information are not as worried about computer-based trading taking away their jobs. As a result, I'm going to give this episode a buy rating. Please like and subscribe, and I will see you soon in our next reaction video when we react to season 3, episode 4. Thank you.